There were so many ships coming in, and nearly all of them had gay people on board. I have a nice little relationship with the cabin boy off one of the Irish boats. He used to look forward to coming to Liverpool.
In the old days, there were sailors everywhere.
It was brilliant, sex-wise, and the clubs and stuff.
We'd sometimes go out, and, you know, the big thing was to try and find out if there were sailors around, because that was a dream.
There were a lot of gay men chasing sailors, and sailors were a big part of it, and merchant ones as well as royal ones.
Yeah, Blue Funnel, Harrison Line, Bibby Line.
Foreign visiting sailors, you know, a French ship came in, and a shipload of sailors with red pom-poms on their heads, and they were being chased all over the place.
In fact, I had one relationship with the ship's doctor. Anybody who came off the ship sometimes were quite happy to take you back on.
When the ship wasn't in, there was no party, there was no clubs open, no one could go out, nothing happened. But as soon as that ship come into port, the whole town kicked off again.
Well, everybody knows where Liverpool is. Everybody. So, which is quite good. New meat, kind of thing.
The city was a major seaport at that time. So from Herculaneum Dock in the Dingle to Uskerson Dock in the north, there was a cottage outside of every dock gate.
Well, the cottage scene was, of course, the main scene for most people.
The only way you could meet gay people was by cottaging.
And, I mean, some of the toilets, what was going, they were like ballrooms.
They all had nicknames. One of the first ones was the one at the bottom of James Street on the Gorey, called the Garden of Allah. And that was really busy because the main bus station was down at the pierhead and the boats, and so all the people who went to the Wirral and everything. It was always busy, and it was always great for trade.
The most spectacular cottages were the Wheel of Fortune by the Playhouse, which was a circular underground place.
Famous people went in there, and you never knew who you were going to meet in there. It was one of the busiest in town, wasn't it?
And half of the cast from the Playhouse, no doubt. The stations were good. Lime Street station was excellent.
Head office, yeah.
Most people, but all these names, because you didn't want to say you're going to a toilet in that street, they all had nicknames. It was illegal, so you couldn't say, I'm going to this place, that place. You'd use the nickname.
A lot of people couldn't go to clubs for fear of being seen by somebody they knew, whereas they could have anonymous sex in a public toilet.
This Victoria cottage, I've never seen nothing like it in my life. It was like a club. It'd be chocking in there, full of men, all cruising, because they want to cop off. And this nice, we're all in there, because everyone's like that. And I just thought it was unbelievable. Next minute, the van's open at the top. All the police ran in and thrown us all in the van. And I was only young, and I was like, well, I'm only there having a wee. Anyway, this fella who was sitting next to me said, I'm actually married, you know. I went, oh, yeah. He said, I don't know what my wife's going to say. He said, well, you'll have to come clean now, won't you, lad?
Well, the police would be hanging around outside, or they would be patrolling with their light on.
Big flashlight, yeah, on the car.
Lots of people used to go there and then end up in the jail, which was round the corner.
They used to pick out a couple of officers that knew were gay and put them in cottages to entice you. And then that's how a lot of people were arrested, because they sort of, we call it, abated people to commit acts, and then they turned on them and arrested them.
A lot of people who go cottaging, of course, had a lot to hide, had a lot at risk, and they were perfect to pick off. And so that whole agent provocateur thing used to incense me and upset me. You'd hear about it so often.
If people got caught, I mean, they were immediately carted off. They would be charged of indecency, gross indecency in a public place.
I went out one night and picked a lad up on the way, and going back into Aldersey, we stopped in the quiet lane, as I thought, and it wasn't. A policeman came up behind and said we'd been playing around with each other, and that was it. I was taken into police station, into court. Magistrates Court and then Crown Court at Chester on the charge of gross indecency.
Some people left the area. They moved to London out of the way because they were named and shamed in the papers, and the press had a field day on printing it. Loved to print stories like that.
We constantly heard of people being mugged and there were quite a few people got bashed up in public toilets. The police certainly were quite heavy-handed, and you know, one or two people really got beaten up, but there was not much they could do about it because we hadn't got very much on our sides then.
Police in Liverpool in the 60s and 70s were known as the Liverpool and Brutal Constabulary, and they were known as the Liverpool and Brutal.
Because they'd arrest people who were doing something like that, snogging, or if they were around in a back alley, just bring them out. Yeah, we saw you showing your willies or something like that, and just, you know, accuse them before they've even asked them what they were up to and that. And
I do know people who told me about raids on their houses where they would raid places for people having sex.
When I first got stopped by the police like 20 years ago, and they didn't know what to do with me because they'd never seen no one like me before. We can manipulate the police, because what we do is we just come on to them and they shit themselves and they leave you alone.
I think that most people were very weary of the police.
They weren't all bastards, but the police were bastards.
But I'm sure that they would be the first to admit that their attitude to gay people up to 15 years ago was dreadful.
They only started changing, I think, in late 80s, and even, you know, some of them then were not very nice.
Until nationally, really, they introduced the idea that you had to have warnings before you got round to arrest.
My understanding is that the police, in fact not just the police, sort of society as a whole, didn't have anything like as good a relationship with the LGBT community back then as we have now.
These days, they have to officially have a united front so that they're gay friendly. Then there were gay friendly police and there were gay completely not friendly police, and it just depended who they were, and different police would use things like arresting people for cottaging to boost their arrest rates, but otherwise be quite pleasant.
We all look back on the past and hear about the things that have happened, and that just makes us all the more determined to move things on.
So we've come a long way with the police. They're not as bad as what they used to be.
Black Cat was the first gay club in Liverpool, go back to 1971. I mean, the first place that you could actually drink into the early hours of the morning, and the place where you could dance. But you actually went in a back alleyway, which was a fairly frightening dark back alleyway, and when you had a key to get in, it was all a big novel experience.
We had to creep into clubs, and it was very cloak and dagger. There was none of this sort of queuing up on the pavement in drag and stuff like that. You couldn't do anything like that years ago. It was very knock on the door and wait to be asked in, and you had to identify that you're actually gay.
But the great thing about the Black Cat was it was the first place where two men could hold each other when they danced, and the police would come in and wouldn't bother about it.
The first gay bar I ever went to was the Spanish House, which was sort of part of Victoria Street. It was a very strange place.
It was rough. It was rough, sawdust on the floor.
Very rough.
It wasn't a gay bar, it was frequented by gays.
If you went to the toilets and somebody fancied you, they smashed the light in the toilet so it was all dark.
Never happened to me.
The Stoke Hotel was a sort of upmarket place to go where you went and had a drink in a cocktail bar. It wasn't a place normally you went on your own. It was somewhere where you went, perhaps if you'd met someone somewhere else, and you wanted to meet again, but you weren't immediately dashing off to bed.
Nineteen Gambier Terrace was the first sort of drop-in centre after we'd advertised in the Echo. People came for a cup of coffee, and for a lot of people it was the first time they'd ever met another gay person or a homosexual person. It was a very emotional time because some of them couldn't even get past this front door, and we had to come down, take them up in the lift, and some of them cried because it was the first time they'd ever met anybody. And remember, this was the early 60s. It was still illegal to be out on the streets and all the offences that can be committed. So really, it was the first time a lot of people were at ease.
The 1967 Sexual Offences Act came about eventually because of the Wolfenden Report, which had been written as long before as 1954 and had recommended some decriminalisation of sex acts between men.
The day that the law was changed and passed, I think there was a lot of bottles of champagne were cracked. A lot of us probably had a few drinks too many. It was a day then. We really, most people probably had a little weep. You know, it was something you've been working for, and it was just such a relief.
The 67 Act, although it was a breakthrough because it had finally done something about men having sex together, was very partial. It basically exempted men from prosecution rather than actually abolish the offences, which didn't actually happen until 2003. This was all still very condescending. I mean, Roy Jenkins, who was allegedly a liberal, described homosexuality as a disability for which people shouldn't be punished twice. Just one reason behind the change in the law.
I mean, we were only half the battle then. I mean, it was okay having the law changed, but changing public opinion then, it was going to be another nightmare.
There was still the social dimension to it. There was the press who tortured gay people, frankly. There was the church, and of course Liverpool was full of big Catholic families and was controlled by the church. The church hated gay people. There was the police. There was the schools who told you how bad it was to be a gay.
The whole thing was a landmark in that it was, in a way, a place for people to start with overt campaigning for something better.
The Northwest Homosexual Law Reform Committee changed its name to the Campaign for Homosexual Equality and took on all the other aspects of equality apart from the law.
CHE then spread all over the country.
A friend started very hesitantly with just four or five of us with our home phone numbers taking calls from people who wanted to talk about something like problems.
It was like a Samaritans, but for gay people.
Barbara Branton was a forceful woman who believed in an inclusive gay community. She was one of the first women to man phones on Friend Merseyside.
When people came in, it didn't matter whether they were women or men. She always wore odd socks, and she said that when people came in, they were so nervous and they'd be looking down. And she said the fact that she had odd socks made them think that she was vulnerable, and so they weren't too worried about sort of opening up to her.
She was a driving force for the inclusion of women, and she was instrumental in there being a separate women's group in CHE.
Barbara had this one day conference called Why Gays Need Counselling, so they all flocked in to say we don't. She said that will bring them in. And it did. I realised after Barbara died, I wasn't the only person who'd lost her. Everybody else had lost her as well.
I mean, I think the women's cause, in terms of making women prominent in gay life, lost a huge amount.
During the last 10 years, gay contact groups have been formed all over the country. In Liverpool, the Friend organisation counsels homosexuals who want to join their gay community. On Saturday, Friend hired a bus to London for the march.
One of the prides that I went down to London was on this particular coach, and I actually didn't know we were being filmed for Wales in Action until I actually got on the coach.
Half the Liverpool party sat on one side of the coach out of view. The rest were happy to be identified.
The journalist had said that one half was so closeted we can't photograph them. In actual fact, they were all bladdered because we'd gone to Harry's in the morning for a cheeky bev.
I saw the film later on World in Action, and it was really great to see people going down something that was free and quite political as well and community-led. It was just like an amazing day. And going down to London, obviously, it was more kind of cosmopolitan.
It was a moment in gay history on Merseyside. I think it was very, very, very important.
I liked going in the Bear's Paw, and it was friendly.
It was a gay bar.
The interior design was tasteful.
Well, it was all wood inside and all wood beams and that, because it was a really old pub.
Everybody used to say that the Bear's Paw was piss elegant. Never quite knew what that meant, but I think it meant that lots of people came from the Wirral.
Gordon was tight as a crab's arse. I always remember we used to have grills because we were a club. You couldn't serve direct to the public. So what he'd done is he just got beads. Like Gypsy Rose Lee beads.
It was like a piano bar.
Like that. You know, shaped like a piano. And just had beads.
And all the beads all the way around. You just, yes.
Gordon Shearer was morose, grumpy.
Very flash.
It was a good looking fella, actually, Gordon's. It was about 6 foot odd. A big fella. He used to be a seaman.
Lots of rings and aftershave.
Evil Queen, but dead funny.
I think he drove a Rolls.
You have to give hands up to him because he started off in 1970, when hardly anything was going. He had the Bear's Paw, which was like one of the first gay clubs going. That went for a couple of years. And then he bought Paco's, which he had for 20-odd years.
And Paco's I loved, because to me, again, that was quite a clean, pleasant, quite modern bar. And again, I like the idea of you going down into the depths and finding this strange cave with its bizarre design ceiling.
All the... Like, yeah. The torture chamber coming down.
I think the first bar I went to was probably Paco's, which seemed like a bit of a dump, really, but I think all bars were then.
The maddest thing about Paco's was they used to have pictures of film stars on the wall, like Dinah Dawes and James Dean and stuff, but they didn't have them in photo frames. They had them in, like, there was red tape, you know, like electrical tape.
The odd characters would go in, older gay men particularly, and you could sit and have a chat and have a drink.
People used to put it down, you'd say, oh, it's a dive or whatever, but the people in there was generally an older crowd in there, and they were so protective of me.
It was dead friendly. You could go in there and really enjoy yourself, you know, with the lads and the... It was dead friendly.
And then, of course, the delight of delights, the jewel in the corner, Monica.
Monica was the most amazing person. I mean, for years and years, she was a barman in the Lisbon.
She'd get rotten. She'd go out on her break, and she used to drink these little gold label barley wines. I'd tell her off, and then she'd go, that's it, I'm leaving.
Monica and a bun.
I always remember the bun, the hair snatched up into the bun, thin and wizened.
Probably only about 5 foot and about 6 stone.
Monica was olive oil. With the bun and the glasses.
She was loved by, I think, every gay guy that went into Paco's, you know?
She was like the mother of the gay scene.
She had three husbands. And she said she killed all three of them.
She wouldn't take any shit from anybody.
We used to get gangs coming down in the beginning, and she'd come down the steps, and she'd stand in the middle of them and said, well, the first punch, you punch me. Said, otherwise, the lot of you out now.
She had something to do with a bottle one night.
And the cottage was in the middle of the road then.
Victoria Street.
And she'd make a point of walking to the front of the cottage, to the steps, and shout, good night, boys. And everybody downstairs stopped whatever they were doing and shout, good night, Monica.
Characters running things stood out for a different reason.
The lesbians who did frequent town all the time were sort of quite famous, if you know what I mean. Everybody didn't know the second name, but everybody knew their first name. Esther was a famous lesbian, and she presided over the bar in the Black Cat.
We used to knock around with Josie Dickow, an amazing gay character, really strong, dead butch, and could knock anyone out.
Josie Dickow used to tap dance down them stairs.
We used to tap dance right along the bar. We stand at the end with a gin and tonic waiting for him to finish tap dancing.
He really was so graceful.
When he was good, he was very, very good. You know, when he was bad, he was horrid.
He'd have these rages.
One of the oldest men in Liverpool. And nobody had argued with him in the end.
And he used to bar them from town.
But I did see him and say, he'd be fight once in the Bar Royal. That was mad, because I don't know, I was with, well, I wasn't with him, but I was talking to a fella called John the Murderer, blind fella. He used to work for the council, but he found a body in the lake. So he got the nickname John the Murderer. So that stuck with him for like 40 years. But I was just talking to him, and the next thing, he just ducks, and I thought, what's going on? And the next thing, Sadie and Josie are boxing, but Sadie had thrown a plant pot at him, just like down. Josie ducked, it's then John the Murderer ducked, and I thought, bloody hell, the next thing.
Everyone, by tradition, had ended up in the Bar Royale, which was actually known as Sadie's.
You go to Wood Street through the little rat run to Sadie's from the Mazzy. It was about a minute and a half, 2 minute run.
Well, Sadie's was always a bit like going to your nan's parlour.
You'd generally hear Sadie before you could see the doorman or the club.
He used to hang out the top window and you'd show up downstairs and he'd be looking down at you and he'd be going,
you know, like a crow.
What?
Who is it?
Fuck off, you bard.
No palloons. They go, but I'm not a palloon. let that one in then.
He'd open the door and look out. What?
And he'd either look out and say, all right, come in. Or he'd get a bucket of ice cubes on your head.
Our best mate who we grew up with, there was me, Sian, and a girl called Judah Quigley. And we tried to disguise her as a man to get her up the stairs past Reg, the doorman. And we put like a handicap cap on her and like got a mascara wand and like done like a moustache and like a bit of a stubble. And we got her about halfway up the stairs. He went, hey, come back here, no fucking fish.
Hated women to death.
The more glamorous the woman was, the less he wanted you in there.
Sadie was scary. There's no two ways about it.
He was terrifying.
Very stocky bloke. I mean, very archetypal sort of docker to look at.
Or Eddie Yates, like so not gay.
Ooh, she was massive. She was very, very big, but she's dead, isn't she? She was ugly.
He was monstrous.
But you'd never, ever would say that to Sadie, unless you'd already been lashed out.
Sadie looked like Punch from Punch and Judy. It was the two ends of Punch and Judy. She was like that, and she was like that.
Imagine a Bob, page boy Bob, wig on me.
He used to get sent up, but he could give back what he took.
He was a lovely, lovely guy, but there was another side to Sadie. He was a very, very hard man.
He had to be known that he could look after himself and he wasn't going to get anybody get one over him.
Could pick up four queens under one arm if they were fighting and throw them out.
A complete and utter character that was meant to be. You know, it was meant to be.
Harry and his partner Stephen opened a basement bar which was called The Masquerade.
And you go down and hear, you know, booming out the typical disco fare of that period, utter shite. But the excitement as you were going down those stairs, because when those doors opened, your potential lover, your tall, dark man, could be in that club.
It was all red lit everywhere. It was like an old brothel.
I mean, the club itself was absolutely wrong.
You had to keep walking, otherwise you're stuck in the carpet.
It stayed open forever. It was like the war had never happened.
It felt like the British Legion of faggots.
He could have been out to make money out of us, and he knew no one had nothing.
Say about 12, half past 12 of a night, there was a kitchen part, but he didn't cook meals and stuff. He would make cheese and brawn spam sandwiches for everybody.
Some sort of double doors would open, and he'd come out with a plate of sandwiches. Do you want a sandwich, dear? Sandwich.
God knows what was in them, I never ate any.
Spam.
Spam,
yeah.
I mean, cheese on a bussy with a bit of meat. It was just like, no.
Occasionally put bands on.
Elvis used to be in there, the DJ, called Elvis, yeah. He was ahead of the time.
There was Sabonga, who used to get his tambourine out and dance.
And when the DJ equipment broke down, Harry, not to be beaten, would bring down his white plastic Fidelity stereo, stick it on two tables, and someone had just changed records.
And we'd dance to Donna Summer, State of Independence, do all your dance moves.
It was very high energy, camp. It's the only way I can explain it, but disco, very Sylvester. Do you wanna funk?
At the end of the night, all the gays would get together and link arms and sing a daft song.
You did see the odd scrap in there, but it was not vicious.
Some nights you'd see boxing matches where tables were being right the way down the bar, and if he'd come back again, he'd just be moving out the way and carrying on while people were killing one another.
Harry used to look mahogany or teak in colour.
Tan to fuck. Probably even had a bit of eyeliner, but subtly.
He got into taking these tablets that made him orange, carrot things when they first came out.
His hair was, I can't describe it, sort of longish and blown under, and it was as stiff as a board.
I said, you dye your hair? He said, no, but I said, you bloody do.
His hair was black, jet black. I used to say to him, Harry, what dye do you use, love? Book and shoe polish.
Harry never put blue polish on his hair. He dyed his hair with love and care every day.
The only other camp people I would put in a category as Miss Harry would be Kenneth Williams and Joe Autry and them. He was like them. He was older than them.
He actually looked, if you've ever seen the Italian fashion designer Valentino, he looked like a cut price Valentino.
Like Frankie Howard, oh, you're a case. You're a case. Oh, she's a case, this one. She's a case.
He was an amazing man, absolutely. I don't think the Liverpool gay scene did enough for him.
It didn't matter whether you were young, old, black, white. You were welcome in the Mazzy, weren't you?
Yeah.
Certainly someone who should be canonised as a gay saint. There is no question.
The feminist movement was happening, you know, even when I was a child.
I think what the 60s gave us was a sense of that justice, that the world didn't have to be the way it was. We forget now how circumscribed women's lives were in those days, you know. I mean, you couldn't sign a hire purchase agreement, you had to have a man's signature.
There was a big feminist movement in the 70s, and there'd be like marches, like of a night time, down Princess Avenue especially, with hundreds of women and the men at the back supporting them, you know, reclaiming the night. It was called Let's Reclaim the Night because women weren't safe out on the streets and that.
They suggested a curfew for women, didn't they? You know, someone pointed out it would actually be more logical to have a curfew for men.
The feminist movement became part of the gay girls' family anyway, because they supported us as well.
There was a lot of conflict, though, between feminists, lesbians and, you know, the lesbians who weren't really all that political.
For the most part, feminism paved the way for women and for their right to choose their sexuality. Politically, them women showed us how to fight. They showed us how to conduct a struggle, and they showed us how to keep going. And that's what was important, from the softliners to the hardliners. They showed us that we had to always stand up for ourselves and never give in.
The Gay Pride Week in Liverpool was a collective of people from all walks of the gay movement, Fringe, CHE, Gay Activists Alliance, of which I was part of. Gay Switchboard. We wanted this festival in Liverpool, which was about politicisation. It was about the arts. It was about theatre. There was Dr. White and the Lalettes, which was Chris Bernard, Margie Clark, Frank Clark.
It was surreal. It was mental. It was different. I don't think we were just expressing ourselves, and we were going to go for the jugular.
It was just pretty outrageous for its time. It was sexually quite liberating.
We were just going to go and give them hell and thought we were fabulous, and the gay scene hasn't got nothing like us. Do you know what I mean? We're professionals. We know what we're doing. They won't forget us in a hurry, and they didn't.
There was murder at that show. It really caused controversy.
Colin came on and started to do his drag. Well, it all fucking kicked off.
Loads of women took exception to it, and someone threw a pint of lager in our Frank's gob.
And there was a fucking riot.
Loads was getting swilled all over the gap like that.
But weirdly, all then went into this loving, where everyone had, we all sort of pleaded our case. And I suspect that the poor bastards from CHE and Friend, who never actually did a Mersey gay pride again. I wonder why. Must have cooled down the situation and everyone was fine. And I remember some of the women in the front row ended up having a pint with and having a laugh with later on.
Liverpool!
Hello!
Let Expression have had a massive impact, really, because it was just really exciting because it was made in Liverpool. You take things for granted now because we've had Mersey Television here, so we're so used to having film crews in Liverpool. But then it was still like a really exciting time.
Hollywood came to Liverpool and it was a really bleak time in Liverpool. You know, there was the miners' strike, there was Thatcher, AIDS, you know, it was just a horrible time. There was no employment, there was no money or anything. So the cameras thrown into town and everyone you knew was in Letter to Brezhnev. All the extras, everybody, it was all people you knew. It was really sociable. And then one of us was the star of the show. It was Margie Clark, one of the girls.
I think because it's telling our story, you know, it's our tale. And that's why people love it, when you can see yourself being represented.
Frank Clark was such a brilliant, brilliant writer. And it's his gay sensibilities as well, because Margie Clark and Alexandra Pig could be. I did read something where he said it was two gay men. The story was two gay men, and he changed it to make it more palatable or marketable.
Brezhnev is sort of based on a true story of things that happened to Frank and I with foreign sailors.
You've got Teresa, who's the big blousy one, you know, opens her heart out and makes out that she's brave, and she is, and she's the scaredy cat. And you've got Alexandra Pig, who's the girl next door, but a predator, you know, actually goes out and does it. And they showed archetypal images. And I think that the survival thing about is very strong, isn't it? In Scousers, and the gay community identifies with that. Because it's tough, isn't it? It's a tough life, but fantastic. We love it and want more.
I got you this.
What's that?
Vodka.
It was a gay film. I mean, everybody involved in it. Not everybody, but all the key players involved in it had a great affinity with the sort of whole gay thing. All were gay.
Suddenly you weren't the only person out there. You weren't the only person going to these venues. It was a whole city and then a whole nation who were able to see, you know, what we were as a gay community. And I think that that's why Liverpool gay community has remained so strong over the years, because we had great foundations with those people out there really, really doing it.
That was a great time. Actually, looking back, that 80s explosion, like Frankie's and Pete Burns, Dead or Alive, Brezhnev, it was a really good time for Liverpool.
Holly really worked it for everybody, you know, especially when he brought out Relax, and then it got banned, and so everyone bought it then. I don't know whether that was necessarily targeted at the gay community. I think he was telling everybody else to relax and just get on with it, really. He is an icon of putting gay music out there.
Suddenly, I saw people who were pop stars, you know, who were openly gay. So it did change for us as gay people, and our gay rights and stuff like that long term. That was all part of making a huge difference to where we were coming from as a gay community, because we had those people representing us out there and doing a fantastic job, and we're making things happen big time within the music scene and stuff like that. So it was a huge influence.
I mean, the likes of Frank Clark coming from Kirby. Kirby's a rough place, and like, and there was Frank Clark going, yeah, I'm gay, easy. And what? I've just made a film. Wow. Brilliant.
It was amazing. A liberating experience. And then to see yourself on screen in a Hollywood movie that's premiered at Cannes and things like that. In a way, it was an affirmation, an underground affirmation of that, yeah, you can do it. There is life beyond. But again, when those cameras went away, you were still left. No, it was still the same old grindingly hard, difficult city.
The gay movement changed forever from 81.
There is now a danger that has become a threat to us all. It is a deadly disease and there is no known cure.
Boy, AIDS, 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 AIDS. Oh, God. Just the... I actually swear to you, as we talk, I've got cold shivers going up my legs and up my spine. Because you bury it, you try to get rid of it. I feel uncomfortable now remembering.
The virus can be passed during sexual intercourse with an infected person.
Kenny, who was a steward on one of the passenger ships, was one of the first to catch AIDS, and it was very quick in the early days. He'd gone in months. In fact, he set himself on fire to finish himself off.
If you've ever seen an AIDS death, you'll know what I mean. It's disgusting. It's incredibly painful way to die.
People would tell you somebody had died every other day. And I've never been to so many funerals in my life, and I hate them ever since. It was a devastation.
You didn't really grow up with death as part of your life, you know, because in the post-war generation, we were all a lot healthier, you know, people live longer. And to have something like AIDS come along where young people were dying.
There are no words, really. I think the reason why people can't sort of openly grieve about it, because it was so overwhelmingly agonizing.
Anyone can get it, man or woman.
I remember it coming out and me and Sian thinking, oh, we've got it straight away, but we're gay, so we've got that. And I was too scared to go for a test or anything, terrified.
So far, it's been confined to small groups.
It's a gay cancer. Everyone's got it. You can catch it off anyone. You've got to be very careful. You mustn't touch anyone. You can't kiss them. You can't do this. You can't do that.
Because the incidence of HIV was high in the gay community early days, that added to prejudice.
It was painful because it was a total and utter lack of understanding, let alone compassion. It was compassionless because people viewed it as something they'd brought upon themselves.
The stigma that was attached to it was just like, you know, abhorrent.
But it's spreading.
The thing was, you suddenly got this whole thing of we are dirty vermin carrying a dirty disease.
The view was, oh, this will stop them, and you know, they're getting what they deserve.
It sort of put this dark cloud over the gay scene where straights were concerned.
It was them and us, which we'd been trying to eliminate for years.
So protect yourself. And read this leaflet when it arrives. If you ignore AIDS, it could be the death of you.
People were like that, worse. They were treating them like lepers, you know? And my friend Eddie got into a fight with someone over it and bit him. It was all in the front page of the Echo. A guy with HIVs bit me and all the rest of it, you know? And it was horrible. Horrible what gay people... I mean, I even know someone who couldn't even go in their own house and have a cup of tea off their own family, in case they caught it off a cup. But that's how they thought. You can't blame them for what the government made people think, because it was their fault to show things like that. They never did it in an educational way, really. They did it like we were to blame.
So don't die of ignorance.
Well, we all believe the shit that everyone else believed, but I think a lot of the older heads, probably the very people that we've been talking about, the lovely people, got an angle on it, and we're getting the message out through the grapevine, if not through the official channels. The message was coming out. I do seem to remember we heard pretty quickly that, in fact, it was transmitted through blood and ergo sperm. So lots of bum holes were kept shut for a long time, I can bet.
The world went berserk. It was a terrifying few years.
A big generation of gay men of my age and a bit older all died. You know, it left a big gap.
But it galvanised the gay community. Because if you haven't got each other, you've got no one.
We lost very dear close people. I have a little picture in my house, and I know that 1,000 other people in Liverpool have a photograph of Brian King, who we lost through HIV. a man who could have been, who would have been very, very important as a writer, as an actor, as a compassionate soul who did so much work against prejudice.
Brian was an absolute party of a human being.
I just think he was like Marks and Spencers, he had something for everyone.
He would dance with anybody and he would talk to anybody, and everybody in his company felt like he was their best friend immediately. When Brian died, it was like, I don't know, it was seismic. The sense of his death in Liverpool was seismic. And Liverpool knew that it lost not just a remarkable human being, but a remarkable gay man.
Not everyone has beaten AIDS, but we know that we can and we must.
The curtain is just the curtain. You go in for the first time and there just seemed to be like a lot of older people in there, sort of a soft porn playing on all the telly screens, which at the time you've never really seen any, you know, may as well be hardcore porn, you're only sort of looking out the corner of your eye anyway.
The curtain, gay porn going in.
So you'd be sitting there with a drink and then maybe you'd look up and you know, someone would be like, you know, having a wank or something on the telly, just be like, oh God.
Just sort of stand transfixed and think, oh my gosh, you know, is this what being gay is?
It was really, really dark and smoky and a bit grubby.
Thought the curtain.
For me, art goes with being gay. I look at the greats like Warhol, Da Vinci, and Michelangelo, and then think they were gay, look what they produced, and then look at the curtain.
It was like the sort of place where you could get your throat slashed.
I remember going to gay bars for the first time. So with me and my friend, we would go, and we'd go into all those places like the curtain. And we'd come out and we'd say, yeah, we are gay. And then we'd sort of go into the curtain and then we'd go, no, we're not gay. No, we're not gay.
Toilets were a bit of a worry.
Wondering if you were going to have to use a snorkel and a wetsuit and very large waders before you went in.
The curtain in its day was the place where if you wanted to cop off, you know that you could go there and there'd always be something available.
I just remember one day this fella, I was about 22 or whatever, and he must have been about 50 or something. I think he must have had his eye on me, but he followed me in there. And like his opening line was, are you butch or bitch?
I mean, it does at first seem like one of the most intimidating places in the world, but as the years went by, I did actually really grow to love the curtain. Because, I mean, I still think to this day it's one of the most unpretentious, you know, places in town.
The Royal Peninsula Group was a place where I first started going out. I'd recently come out of the army, and the Royal Pen was the only place on our side of the water that you could actually go out. It was part of the gay scene, and they accepted transvestites. And so I started going there on a regular basis.
They didn't discriminate between gay, straight, bi, transgender, transsexual. Everybody was welcome and everybody came.
And it was just nice to be accepted as a female, even though at the time when I was dressed, I didn't look very female, but I tried my best and had some very nice compliments off people.
We used to have dances there and sandwiches and bingo and stuff. In fact, Paul O'Grady still asks today, are we still doing the bingo?
And I think that has been my greatest triumph of enjoying those, because I do like to be on the stage and I did like emceeing these.
But that group, every couple of months, used to hire out the ballroom.
The Hotel Victoria Ballroom.
In New Brighton.
They would bring busloads of people.
I mean, 48 transvestites on a bus from Sheffield in the car park was just a sight to behold.
And to have such a good gay event on our side of the water, on the Wirral, it was not known.
And Philip and Margaret, who ran it, they did the best job.
The gay scene had, of course, been totally male-dominated, and a lot of men were misogynistic.
As we built more of a lesbian community, bars started catering more towards that. But in the very, very beginning, most certainly within Sadie's, and within Jodie's and within the Curzon, it wouldn't be very big of an L, a lesbian population there, to be honest with you.
There was a huge, huge gulf between gay men and other people who would now say LGBT, that we were trying to overcome.
The men go every night, they go to their clubs, and we'd only go at Saturdays, Sundays. And I mean, I had to get a babysitter as well, so I'd only go out, say, at weekends.
Well, the weekend started on a Thursday, and that was the Green Bank. And then from the Green Bank, we'd go to the Daly's Dandelion.
Which was a bit of a dive downstairs.
It's all a bit blurred, because by the time I got there, it was a bit worse. So it was all a bit blurred there.
The scene in Liverpool then was quite good. It wasn't bad. We had they had various women's clubs opened and shut, but they shut a lot of the time because we didn't have the money that the men have.
That night was Follies.
Friday night.
Was it Friday? That was good, actually. Follies was good.
Friday, straight from work, we would probably go to the Lisbon.
And you'd have different people in different places as well, wouldn't you? So Mask, which is still there now, that was always quite a nice place to go to.
Saturday would be back in the Lisbon if you weren't too hungover. And then Sunday probably would be Lark Lane, Keith's. And then you just dry out for a few days and you start again.
The Lisbon's still there. What can I say about the Lisbon? It's never changed.
Everyone in Liverpool's experienced that first terrifying walk down those steps into the Lisbon.
I mean, everyone used to talk to everyone in the Lisbon.
There was a drag show on anyway. They used to come and borrow the drops off the chandeliers for earrings, you know, to wear. They'd do, can I take a couple of, you know?
Well, I know we weren't supposed to, but we used to have to shut at 3, but all the gay scene used to come out on a Sunday afternoon. So I used to just shut the doors and put pea soup and everything on for them and used to stay all afternoon.
I feel very at home in the Lisbon, and it's a very interesting pub. Again, if you bring visitors to the city, to the Lisbon, they've never seen anything like it, and their amusement is huge.
When I first used to go to the Lisbon, I just remember it being more exciting as a place. So it wasn't necessarily to do with sort of being gay, really. It was just a place where more alternative people went.
I mean, I've been into the Lisbon, but I run out as fast as I walk in. I have to tell you. I'm so sorry. I have to tell you. I run in there and then I say, well, my God, it's like, you know, Star Wars. You know, the bar at Star Wars. I went, my God.
Being seen in the Lisbon didn't necessarily mean you were gay, you know, if you were sort of younger and not ready to come out yet.
Another thing about the Lisbon was the pool table, which was just the domain of the lesbians in there. And that part of the bar, really, we sort of avoided. Quite often, there'd be a fight. You'd hear, like, the crack of, like, a cue stick cracking on somebody's head.
I think I've been barred from the Lisbon about 3 or 4 times, but then I think most people have. So I think it's, like, a badge of honour.
Josie's was always brilliant. Always. It was death friendly, always chocker. It was about the atmosphere. And it was about your mates. And it was about the music.
At the beginning, it was sort of like high energy music. And then sort of like house music was creeping in then. So Jodie's was basically the first gay club to play house music.
Was very much the music that was happening, Studio 54, whatever was happening, Studio 54 New York, it was our little Liverpool version of that. And I remember people like Grace Jones, Holly Johnson, anyone big who played on the Royal Court would turn up and be in there. So you could walk in there on a Saturday night and see anyone from Tracy Wilder to Grace Jones. You know, it was one of those crazy places. They also had acts on.
Like people like Aethe Kitt, who were like once like, you know, A-list stars, and Sinise's mum, Mikel Brown, who had a like massive hit with like So Many Men, So Little Time.
I remember Sharon Redd being on, and I was just like so starstruck by her. Do you remember her? Can you handle it? Did it?
I think Divine was even on once. You know, he'd have drag acts and strippers and stuff.
And if the acts were crap, the DJ would get cans of red stripes thrown at him. So in the end, he had to put a cage around.
It was all lit by ultraviolet light. And everyone was in like stonewashed denim because it was the 80s. So it was like quite visually, quite almost like looking at a Liberty print or something. It was quite psychotropic in a way. And it was just like marble washed denim, white t-shirt, moustache. That's walls of that.
Jodie's was the worst door you could possibly work on, because there was a, obviously here there's a door, there's your pavement, and you had about five or six feet, that's all. And then this flight of 17 or 18 steps.
There was one floor where there was a bar and people, sorts of tables, people mingling. And you looked down, there was like the middle was cut out and you sort of looked down, it was like a balcony onto the dance floor below.
Bit of a shit tip, to be honest with you. I remember where we particularly stood was the pool table underneath the toilets, and there was all bin bags on the ceiling, and we'd be dancing away. It was the drug culture then, so perhaps we'd be a little bit high, and we'd be dancing away, and there'd be all this water dripping on us, and we'd be like, oh, this water's lovely. And, like, as you went upstairs, we suddenly realised it was piss coming down us.
One night, I fell down the stairs in there. I think I slipped, and then when I stood up, I was to put my hands on the floor to stand up, and then obviously I was fine, but then throughout the night I must have like touched my face, and when I got in it was black because the floor in Jodie's was just filthy, it was minging.
If we think Stanley Street is important now to the gay community, all we had was those clubs that finished at 2 o'clock and no one has want to go home. So the way that Stanley Street is, there's lots of venues with steps outside. So we'd all sit on the steps till 4 or 5 o'clock in the morning, and everyone would be off their heads, and we'd be smuggling cans out and all stuff like that. Again, if Shagger's Alley become famous, it was because of the fact that Stanley Street and Jodie's and everyone would hang around there 2, 3 o'clock in the morning, and the cruising would be carried on then down in Shagger's Alley, which is down at the back. Again, all of that's changed now. We've kind of cleaned ourselves up a little bit, but happy days. Happy days, yeah.
The women's movement really, really challenged the way that women were forced to dress and the sort of dress codes that you had and the sort of femininity, and wanted to really bust stereotypes. And that just wasn't just for lesbians, that was for straight women as well.
Society's ideal then was you always looked neat and tidy and your hair was a particular style. You know, if you were a girl, you know, you wore makeup and you were prim and proper, you didn't swear, you only drank little glasses of wine and stuff. But the gay girls, they drank pints.
You had to be butch or femme.
And the butch dressed like a man and the femme dressed like a woman.
If you were butch, you had to have tattoos.
You all had suits on, fobs, you know, tattoos.
All the ones in the frock sat down, and all the ones in the jeans stood at the bar.
You had to smoke ciggies like that.
They'd have the hair cut short, like Mansell.
You had to have short hair.
Check shirts and jeans.
Doc Martens, 501s.
Ties and waistcoats.
They dressed like men, a lot of them did, you
jeans.
Know.
Jeans, an awful lot.
Yeah.
If you wanted to wear makeup, no way. If you had long hair, well, you didn't.
And there was never a hair slide or a bit of lipstick in sight.
A lot of women chose, I did as well, you dressed butch, you looked butch, you acted butch.
I suppose that was our security, you know, wearing the same and going around as a pack.
I got a lot of stick as a young lesbian because I was what they call a lipstick lesbian, right? Now, a lipstick lesbian could be a positive thing. It's like how you're making the way for us just to be what we want to be. But it could also be frowned upon by some of the hardliners.
I felt obliged to get my hair cut all short. I've half an inch all over, dye blonde. Had to look a certain way because it was connected with sexuality.
That definitely wasn't fair. I will always throughout my life held on to the right to wear what I want and be who I want. If I want to cut a hole in my jeans and show me arse, I will. The year was 1988, and I believe it was the 8th of July that there was a bill being read in Parliament, which was very negative for the gay community.
Clause 28 was an evil, nasty law that was brought in by Margaret Thatcher in the 1980s to stop councils promoting homosexuality in schools.
They wanted any reference to homosexuality to be kept out of the classroom on the basis that it would corrupt children's minds.
You were not allowed to identify anybody, even in history, as being gay.
There was a certain amount of ignorance because you weren't quite sure what you could discuss and what you couldn't.
So if you were talking about music and algebra, you were not allowed to say that Peter Pears and Benjamin Britten were an item. He was a good friend.
People were frightened
They didn't know whether they were on the right side or the wrong side of the law. It was a shocking piece of legislation.
It was like it was a witch hunt, I suppose.
And it made me think of, like, something that happened in Germany, you know, where they took all the books out of the library and burnt them all. It was almost to that effect.
The whole gay culture was never mentioned in school. We never spoke about it. I thought I was the only person, didn't realise what I was going through.
So if a kid comes to them and said, I'm gay, but you're not, don't speak to me about it.
As soon as they passed that clause, it was almost like, you know, an injection of fear that you wondered what was going to happen next.
There was a real sense of anger about Clause 28 itself, but it was much wider than that. It was a sense of the injustice of a parliament that could be addressing some real issues that were affecting people, that instead was passing this nasty, petty, homophobic piece of legislation.
Thanks a bunch, Mrs. Thatcher.
Can you imagine what that did for the slightly 50-50 homophobes? They became 100% homophobes. They're going to interfere with our kids. They're going to affect our children. Absolute bollocks.
There's one story I know of a young lad who was came out when he was about 12, shortly before it was repealed in 2002, say, and he came out openly because he didn't see a problem with it. His parents didn't see a problem with it. But the school told him that he wasn't allowed to get changed for PE with the other boys, because it was a direct breach of Clause 28, that it was illegal for him to do that. So we had to get changed with the girls.
It was basically, it made you feel like you were a second, third class citizen because of your sexuality.
Couldn't have a relationship or break up and tell anybody. You had to keep it all to yourself. It was all completely quiet. It was like hidden. It was like, because I would have got sacked, or I certainly wouldn't have got promotion.
We're going to have a return to this horrendous cycle of hate and fear and mistrust, lives being drastically affected in a negative way. Misery, horrendous misery, when there was just no fucking need.
I simply can't forgive that moment in time, because it was brutal. I mean, beyond brutal. Don't get me wrong, there was an absolute wonderful sense of collective organisation against it.
I sat in a living room one day with three other women, Colette Power, Sandy Hughes and Libby Gallagher, and we were talking about Clause 28 and that we had to do something about it.
I tried to persuade people, don't talk about it as in political theory and political statements, because you don't really win through people who are not lesbian gay. What you want to do is actually say it personally. Why should I be a second class citizen? Why should I be hidden?
And we ended up with three venues, Unity Theatre, Mid-Side Trade Union Centre. We had the picket with the stage in it, and we had the picket rooms where we put all the stalls and information and stuff. And Hardman House, where we had a big ball in the night.
So we actually arranged for gay and lesbian couples to go and visit the councils we thought may vote against our opposition to Clause 28. And they lobbied them. And that had a really profound impact.
And we made our opinions very clear through bringing politicians up to speak, bringing acts from all over the country. I think ours was one of the biggest responses to Clause 28.
We actually got a phone call from Margaret Thatcher's office to complain, how come Liverpool, with all its history of religious tradition, we were the only council that opposed Clause 28 unanimously.
We were approached and we said, what can we do? And we're just a gang of girls, you know what I mean, having a laugh. She said, oh yeah, let's do a little show.
And every man had done a show which had some habits in. They were like the tea towel nuns. So we threw those on. We're like kiss curls and things coming out and big eyelashes. And we did this like little protest thing.
We believe to this day that we made some impact. You know, it didn't stop that bill going through and stuff, but it did make an impact.
I was left with the feeling that actually our community, particularly here in Liverpool, particularly all the people who aren't gay or lesbian or trans, they're pissed off. And that was really important.
A
I've had some fantastic times at Garland's nightclub. It's been absolutely amazing.
I think the word serendipity exists because it happens. It's just people come together. Sometimes if you shine a light, whether it's creatively or socially, birds of a feather will flock to that light. And I think that's what happened with Garland's at that inception. It was the right time, the right place and the right people. Because there was a lack of anything like that in Liverpool, it just went off.
Now, when Garland's opened, Garland's was great, and it was gay, and it was, proper gay.
Garland's was a shock to the system. I went to Garland's a couple of times, and, to walk into Garland's and see men walking around with no tops on, it was just an eye-opener.
It was amazing. It was the best club in Liverpool.
And it was the first time, because that whole sort of rave and druggy and ecstasy culture and everything had just started. And it was the first gay club, I think, that I was aware of, where there was that crossover of gay and straight people.
I remember we got in for the fourth birthday. We had to think of a theme, and I thought, royal. And we didn't stop at just theme and everything, decorations-wise. I came up with, why don't we get the Queen looking likey? When she came on stage and we had like ABBA dancing Queen, and it was like 2,000 people or something in here, and you just heard this voice, the Queen turn, say, "And would the Garland trannies please cut the cake?" And as Tanya and Kenzie went like that to cut the cake was like from the floor to the ceiling. It exploded with glitter bombs, and the whole club exploded with glitter bombs. And that's when I thought, yeah, we've made it. It was nice that these people who, to all intents and purposes, and to the outside world, would be, almost freaks. We had, somewhere where we were not just socially acceptable, but socially fabulous. Places where you're allowed to be you, whoever that may be. I think they'll always have a place in club culture if that's what it's about. And I think Garland's was always about that, given the geek, the freak, the chic, the unique, a setting. Got like a letter or something off the ferry company, would you like to hire for a charity or something? I was just thought, what a brilliant, brilliant idea. And it was the first year of Garland's that summer. I think we'd done 2 or 3 boats that summer, and it just grew. There wasn't even a flyer or a poster for it for the first few. It was just a word of mouth thing, because it was so crazy, surreal and outrageous.
Fantastic, just gorgeous on the sea, in the sunshine. Summertime, everybody off the cake.
Who wouldn't want to dance, on a boat, dressed as a sailor, ha-ha.
When you say Everyman Youth Theatre, you kind of got this emphasis on the word theatre. It wasn't about that. That place was a place where things could just happen. And it was at a time in 1979, 1980, when Liverpool was just humongously creative. So the Youth Theatre was this kind of camp heartbeat in the middle of this great big swelling body of underground and counterculture creative achievement. Even though there were straight people in the Everyman Youth Theatre, the energy was queer and it was anarchic. Even the straights are queer.
There was a gang of queens there, that sort of they were the most interesting people in the youth theatre.
Didn't ask people if they were gay when they came into the Everyman. You'd ask if they might be straight.
Oh my God, this place is full of queers. And then I realised I was home, if you know what I mean. And I took my Doctor Who scarf off, sat down and never looked back, really.
I hope people have a point in their life where they can say, right, this is where it changed. And the Everyman Youth Theatre is where it changed for me. I suddenly, almost immediately, began to understand not who I queer was, but who I was and where I was and why I was.
So the people I met there, Brian King, Jerry Potter, Mickey Poppins, Maria Barrett, Bernie Shaw, Fee Cameron, Karen Gray, all of these people were gay and lesbian people making the way in the world.
It was like a kaleidoscope of colour and energy, and it was fantastic. I remember the first time I walked in there, there's a lad there doing pirouettes. Jette, he's putting his leg behind his head and all that. And I'm standing there, I'm just a scally, I don't know any better. I'm just going,
And I brought one of my mates with me. I was going, look at him over there. Oh, look at him, what's he doing? Oh, they must be gay.
And I'll tell you now, from now on, that Liverpool is now driven by that queer energy from that youth theatre. Nothing, nothing compares to those 3 years at the youth theatre.
If I hadn't joined the youth theatre, I could have easily fell into a lifestyle where I was going out with a girl, because I had a couple of girlfriends, because I had to, because it was, my peers were all, you know, it was in a number of boys' school, all my mates were all straight, didn't really have any gay mates and all.
That theatrical side of Liverpool queer life is so important.
Remember when I was younger, watching Brookside, and then they had a gay character, Gordon Collins, and you always got the sense he became gay because they didn't like him anyway. He was a boring character. And it was just the worst kind of role model, because it was gay Gordon Collins, and he was the most uninteresting character in the soap, and everyone hated him, and it was just made it even harder to be gay, really.
I think most TV shows have, like, the one gay character, and it's usually either a token, you know, a camp person, or, you know, somebody who's really inoffensive and non-sexual.
I think with Lance, he was pretty much gay and was proud of it. So therefore, he didn't really get up for morning and beat himself up or wring his hands or get queer bashed. So he wasn't dealing with the normal issues dramas deal with. I think he was just there for a bit of fun.
I mean, I've been at Brookside for years and they hadn't had a gay storyline for a long time. And it was quite hard still to get anything like that through, because obviously the likes of Phil Redmond, they were worried about viewing figures and were people ready for it. So we were always, a couple of times I tried to get some kind of gay storyline in and never got it through. And then, so it was quite a shock when he agreed to the one that we did with Anna Friel and everything. Also because she was the most, probably one of the most popular character in the show at the time. So it was just I suppose it was a big risk. So many young children just watch soap operas all the time, probably the biggest audience really. And for them, it's just the norm, you know, to have all these gay characters in soaps now. So hopefully that can only have a positive impact.
It when you go all sad on me. Everything's gonna be all right, you know.
There's no real, like, role models on the telly even. Channel 4 was a godsend.
A lot of the time, things aren't listened to and things are brushed under the carpet, as I've said. So I think tackling it in a different way, writing about it, getting people to listen to it. I mean, when Paradise Bound was on, there were a lot of people coming to the theatre who'd never been to the theatre before, which was a huge thing, which, like, I was so proud of that. So I know a lot of the people who were going to see it wouldn't necessarily know how it feels to be coming out, and if someone's gone through the same thing, if they've gone through coming out or homophobia, if you can put something up there that says it's not just you, then it's brilliant. There was that thing in the Daily Hate Mail last year by that Brian Sewell about all the gay people on Coronation Street and how it was ridiculous, and it was, you know, I remember Coronation Street used to have values and all this sort of stuff, and it was just like, oh my God, people can still write that, and that can still be printed, and there are people out there who will lap that up and agree with it. So yeah, I mean, I think as long as you're pissing off people like that, you're doing something right.
I think the best way is to just be a bit kind of subversive and just do your stuff and say, you know, get a load of this.
Say what you like about me, but I've always got a good entrance.
The Rini character came about because I had an Auntie Rini, and she was an absolute scream. She had a massive influence on me.
went, well, I always speak to him afterwards. Oh, that was lovely, that. I said, feel free to wipe your knob on the gate.
I am very outrageous and cheeky, and I think I can get away with it because, you know, when I do Malcolm and stuff like that, you know, I am a gay man.
I'm a gay man, by the way. You probably didn't realise that because I'm quite butch. A lot of my other gay friends are really camp, but I don't agree with it. Camp knocks me sick.
And I've seen that, and they're my, you know, friends and boyfriends. People will come to the show, and I would love this, but I'll never know. They'll sit and watch the show and go, I fucking loved that. What a lovely evening. He cracked me up. I loved it. And then they'll walk out and think, and he was gay. You know what I mean? I mean, that's the best thing you can ever do, really, isn't it? You know, with homophobic dickheads.
When I was a kid, I was brought up in Scotland Road area, Liverpool, and it was dead hard. And I've got this really deep, lovely timbre now. But when I was younger, I was like squeaky Eunice Dubs voice. I looked like a Eunice Dubs glove puppet. That's what I looked like when I was a kid. And I was treated like such by the roughs around my way. And so I was always told, your voice is too gay, your voice is too gay, it's too girly, you talk like a girl. And I think Chloe was that girl's voice turned into a kind of man-woman. So when Chloe came out, there was this raging sort of torrent of eloquent gorgeousness that just had to happen. So Chloe Poems was in effect a beautiful sense of my anger. She came from a completely unrepressed place. So that's what made her freer than me. She wasn't bullied. I was. Chloe wasn't. She wasn't told to shut up because she was too camp. I was. Chloe wasn't.
Monica, what are you putting lippy on for when you've got no lips? And no, you can't bother me leggings. Not for the size of those lips. Put on your rah-rah. Do something about your cough. We're out on the town, we're going to cut off. There's loads of fellas out there dying for a go of us. Monica, what is with that boon shibble with Mr. Fucking Boss? Oh, Monica, I'm off me face. I shouldn't have had that other trip. There's a tap dancing in you kissing me ankles. And I think I'm gonna flame.
She was free. That's what a character does. That's when you adopt a character, when you adopt a persona, that's kind of where I think most people are working from. You're not nailing it down to real life. It comes from a spiritual place where you can actually soar, you know, and I think Chloe did that.
Oh, Monica, is it always going to be this way? When I was a kid, I was told that if I was good, then the world would be mine. When I was good, Monica, and I've got none to show, except for a list of petty crimes. And a friend worth her weight in gold. Oh, Monica, I know we'll still be mates when we get old. And I don't really care if at the time being nothing's but you. Because for the first time tonight, Monica Mulligan, caught up in, does go got you near.
She was a brother. She was a Gingham Boudicca. That's what she was.
The vocal I put on every year celebrates under a safe umbrella the platform of costume through drag theatre, dancing through voguing, which is a gay style of dancing, and also the collaboration of professional choreographers with the gay scene. I think I take a role on the gay scene that sort of helps pioneer younger dancers and younger artists. So I've sort of shifted how I perceive myself within the LGBT and try and give it a good, strong role model. So if I'm talking to anyone, I always think about and also reflect about the work that I do and see how I can support the gay culture in Liverpool.
A lot of the time, LGBT issues have been sort of brushed under the carpet, but through the arts, you can do your thing. You can be who you want to be and say what you want to say.
Love that, isn't it? Do you like that? Very trendy for me, that. I'm down with the kids now. I'm retro cool.
I was going out to G-Bar maybe 5 years ago, and I'd been singing. So I was wearing a fedora and a waistcoat and a pocket watch, and I looked like Dick Tracy, I looked like a 40s detective. And as I was coming out to G-Bar, a little bit tipsy, these two fellas come to one side of me like that. And they were gabbing away, talking a bit of crap. And one of them went, "Watch out, he's gay." And I said, "What do you mean by that?" I said, "I'm also 6'1", I've also got blue eyes, what's the issue with that?" And they started crowding me. Now, my dad was a jiu-jitsu sensei back in the day, so I picked up little bits and bobs. So as they crowded me, threw one of them over, he threw a punch in, I threw him over my shoulder, at which point all the door staff from G-Bar come legging it down. But as it turned to look, there was a crowd at the far end of the alleyway going up to G-Bar. And as essentially what they'd seen is walking past, he looked up an alleyway and there was a detective from the 1940s beating two fellas up, throwing them over his shoulder into the bins and all that. So that was, I suppose it was a laugh for them, but it wasn't much for me.
You do get homophobic abuse all the time, especially if you're dressing like this and you venture out from the gay scene, the more straight you go to, you do get things said at you. Occasionally you do get the bottle thrown at you. Mm.
Being gay was about who you fell in love with. And it was like, isn't that nasty how somebody can put all that oppression and pressure on you because you choose who you fall in love with?
I used to see this guy every day who used to shout "dyke" right in my face.
The bouncer said, "You can't come in and you can take your boyfriend with you."
I have been on the receiving end, rough end of it. Kicked my ribs in and stuff.
And I was queer bashed in Liverpool, and that was hideous. And it's hideous on so many levels because the guy who queer bashed me was sort of copping off with me, and then he battered me to a pulp.
I suppose I was attacked when I was 16 just for being gay. I didn't realise at the time I was obviously exuding gayness. And I was just minding my own business, just walking along the street, and this group of lads came along and started punching me.
A man came out at the pub and started walking towards me extremely quickly. As he walked towards me, all I saw in his eyes was pure hatred. I'd never seen it before in anyone's eyes, ever. And I just literally turned and started to try to get away. And the next thing I remember, I woke up 6:30 next morning in the Royal Hospital in Liverpool.
Nelson Asu was a good friend of mine. He was a good friend to a lot of people.
He's my little baby, lived over the road from me, and, you know, I'd see him all the time. He was my only really gay neighbour that I've had.
He was a loner as well. He always wanted to go out by himself and party hard, get up to mischief, and maybe get into fights, whatnot, you know what I mean? But there was one incident that he went missing, and he went missing for 3 days.
What happened to him should never have ever happened, should not have happened.
What we found out was that Nelson had taken two lads back who then beat him up, tied him up and put a hood on his head and put him in a trunk, which took him 3 days to die. He choked on his own vomit. It shook the gay scene completely. We all went to feeling it was horrendous. The impact it had on the family, people in the family died of a broken heart, his mother died with a broken heart. It was just horrendous.
And it could have been anyone, but it shouldn't have been Nelson. Because he was sort of like, I think if he was still alive today, he'd have been like either a singer or a dancer, or he'd be in the mainstream. He'd have made something of himself. Because he was a talented lad, do you know what I mean?
Michael Causa was an 18-year-old Liverpool lad. He was openly gay, and he went out on a night out with a group of friends one night. The actual outcome of the evening is that Michael Causa was kicked to death. He was set upon by a group of people. He was homosexual, he was out. He was proud, and because of this he died.
The Michael Causa murder has got to be the one thing that's happened in Liverpool recently that galvanised everyone into action. I think we were all just so shocked.
not just by the murder, but by the court case afterwards.
It almost gave the single that somehow murdering a gay or lesbian lesbian in the city is somehow more acceptable than murdering someone else. The sentence, I think, sent out the totally the wrong message. And that disgusts me.
But next tonight, the candlelit vigil attended by thousands in Liverpool in support of a trainee police officer who was beaten up in an alleged homophobic attack.
Yeah, the boyfriend of James Parks led the silent protest, which has been described as a huge show of solidarity for the community in the city.
Leading thousands in a stand against homophobia, Tom Downey lit the first candle at last night's vigil in Liverpool, his feelings echoing the sentiments of all those who gathered.
No more homophobic remarks, no more homophobic attacks. Let's cut it all out, let's stop it.
Those who hurt James, let me tell you, you hurt every single one of us.
Councillor Steve Radford was Liverpool's first openly gay politician. He told the crowd not to accept any kind of prejudice.
Well, ever since the attack on James, different communities within Liverpool have united with one message, that homophobia will not be tolerated.
The James Parks event, that was when anger kicked in. So I think everyone had had horror. So you go from horror through to anger, and that was the enough is enough.
This, when something like that happens, I think we all recognise almost immediately as a scene that something absolutely inhumane has happened, and we can look and say that isn't about us, we didn't do that. I think that's the most important thing about this when things like this happen, is we didn't do that. And we have to look at what did that and why it did that and where that comes from.
It's like, what you can do, you're just going to sit back and let people do that, or you can do something. And I think doing something is the most important thing.
There are still those terribly ignorant, probably themselves maladjusted and dysfunctional people out there, in small quantities hopefully, who will still attack a gay man or a gay woman because of their sexuality. But that will go, and I'm sure it will, perhaps not in my lifetime, but people will become more educated and more understanding, and rightly so.
There is more acceptance, but I don't think that we can become complacent.
People shouldn't stop fighting, though. We're not nearly there yet. If you look at society and sort of weigh it up, it's not nearly equal, and that's what it needs to be.
Liverpool Council and the police and various other organisations have fought to try and get rid of it.
Now, you're meant to report it as a hate crime as soon as anything's said. Well, that's what I do now. Anyone says one word to me, you're queer or anything like that, I'm just on the phone to them. Can I get the police here and arrest these, please?
Sigma is the unit which exists within all of our police areas, and they investigate all hate crime, be it racist or homophobic.
So when we looked at the hate crime stats, it's teenage boys who are the perpetrators of homophobic attacks.
There are real reasons why people are homophobically attacked, really deep-rooted, disgusting reasons why people are murdered or why people are beaten up, and that's because we have still, in our society, a patriarchal notion which is absolutely still out of control. And unless we sort of really, really address that, we will never, ever get to the bottom of this, because that's what it is. It's men think, the men who do that genuinely think they have a right to do that.
It's a city that's dominated by two football stadiums and two cathedrals, so you're sort of sandwiched between masculinity and religion, which neither of them have got really a good track record with LGBT people.
The main obstacles that the LGBT scene and every other scene across the country, throughout the world, has had to get across is ignorance. That's it.
And I think it comes down to education. You have to, without education, you don't have anything. And you can only really educate yourself. You know, you can lead a horse to water, but you can't make it drink.
Our teachers, our parents, our families, our friends, our neighbours, anybody who has influence in our life, let's influence them, let's challenge them. Say, this isn't right.
There was a report that came out must be about 10 years ago now, that said that Liverpool wasn't a very safe place and that people like us didn't feel safe. And I think it crystallised a lot, really, around those two young men.
From the Stormbreak report in the sort of mid-2000s, when Liverpool was characterised as being an extremely homophobic place to live, I think it really shocked people into action.
I think the events of the last few years have forced it to be more open. And you can see that by the way Stanley Street's gone.
Got the rainbow flags on some of the on the street signs, a visible expression of gay identity.
Which says to anybody who knows what a rainbow signifies, this is somewhere where you can come, where you can hang out, where you can feel safe, where you can not be nervous, where you know there's some fun to be had.
On the whole, Liverpool is a very accepting city. Mm. Of all people, really, not just LGBT.
If you're gregarious and challenging, then Liverpool will love you. That's what it will do. And so the big queens get an easier ride than I think some of the other queens.
I love the Liverpool laughter, you know. There's just, you go out on the scene in Liverpool and it's raucous and funny. Sometimes it's kind, sometimes not so kind, but it's never boring. Liverpool Pride welled up out of the communities of Liverpool. It wasn't an organisation that formed to put on a pride. It was a cry from the community and then some people getting together to try and answer that cry.
The word pride is being proud about being gay. And Liverpool, through its history of homophobia, does need pride, I think, more than any other city.
Pride, while it is a very recent event in our history in Liverpool, is massive. I mean, it's huge.
You know, there's not many cities that have such a strong LGBT festival like that.
But I do think that first Pride, when we didn't know who would turn up, we didn't know whether it'd be three men and a dog, and eventually 21,000 people came to that first Pride in 2010. That was an outpouring of feeling in the city, I think. Gay people sick, trans people sick of being attacked, and straight people who are not homophobic, who don't have much of a voice, saying, we're not up for it either.
Liverpool's gay scene and trans scene, oh, they came out for a party.
We walked through the pedestrian shopping area and all the grannies came out of the shops and stood and cheered and clapped as we walked past.
So we came off the plateau, turned corner to go down the hill, and I'm not kidding, there were thousands of people. And I will never forget it.
And we marched past the town hall, which was flying the rainbow flag, which was a hugely, hugely significant moment.
Very famously, I cried all the way around, pretty much as I'm doing now, because it was just the proudest moment. Proud for us as a community. I'm proud of Liverpool.
When we were marching around the city and, you know, young lads, you know, they might look like scally lads and that, and they were all applauding as people were going through the streets, and it was fantastic.
And the Lord Mayor danced with the drag queen along Dale Street, which was tremendous.
I was photographing around there, Stanley Street, and I sat down on the wall by the solicitors and I started crying. The reason why I was crying, I was thinking that everything had gone in the last 40 years on the gay scene. What I've seen, all the older gays who are not here anymore, the gays that I knew who committed suicide, the gays that I knew who died of AIDS, the gays that had to leave Liverpool because of homophobia. And I realised it's a fantastic place to be.
The whole of Liverpool came together that day. And has done the first Saturday of August ever since.
One thing that'll be with me for the rest of my life. What I saw, 20,000 people plus down, everyone, I said, no one can touch me now. You cannot touch me. You cannot touch me. They can't bloody well touch us.
Now I think it's the best time there has ever been so far to be LGBT in Liverpool. I think, for me, we're sort of standing on the shoulders of giants, really.
You haven't just invented the wheel, you know, there have been people there before who've done certain things and been quite groundbreaking, you know, especially at a time when being gay was a criminal act.
The problem that maybe some of our younger LGBT community don't get is actually understanding how those in their 60s and their 70s and their 80s suffered, and they suffered hugely.
It's easily forgotten what the struggle has been, I suppose.
Over a period of years, people forget. And it's not forget, they forget where they come from. I think what it is that time just heals, and you just seem, it's good to be kept in the loop about what's gone on, where we've come from.
Go and sit there, listen to these people's stories and what they've been through to get you where you are now.
I think you have to live in history, otherwise you're doomed to repeat it.
It's the possibility that could happen again, you know. You're not assured of having this great open gay lifestyle.
Attitudes have changed greatly, but my word of warning is don't let it slip back, because what we have now can go. You know, we've got to keep ensuring that we make safe spaces for ourselves, that we, and that's in buildings, but also in people's ethos, you know, that if you have a safe and thriving LGBT community in your city, you've got a safe and thriving city. Because if it's safe for us, it's safe for absolutely everybody.
My advice to young gay people and to anyone is, you know, treat people with respect and you get respect back.
Do everything you want. Hate no one. Try and keep it in moderation.
I think if you was coming out on the gay scene now, it's fabulous that there is a gay scene there to welcome you. You know, that's really healthy.
Enjoy your life. Do not let anybody tell you that what you're doing is wrong.
Be yourself. Stay true to who you are.
Just enjoy it as much as you can, and yeah, get as much as you can while you're young. Because when you get old, nobody wants you. I want you. Oh, thanks.
It might be still difficult, but at least you're a little bit further ahead than we ever were in the 60s and the 70s.
Just keep a steady head on you. I know it's difficult when you've had a good night out, and make sure you have safe sex. I can't stress that enough. I tell these every night in here. Make sure it's covered in rubber or don't sit on it.
Believe in who you are and live your life as happily as you truly can, honestly. And if you love ice cream, eat more of it. That's my advice to you. Don't eyes under your bush, love. Shine your light.